we are very happy that you are here. Professor Göran Sandberg, Executive Director of the Knut and Alice Wallenberg Foundation. You must understand what good research is, you told me, and I think that is what we've just touched upon with Bourguignon's speech. And please give us a picture from your perspective.
Okay, so when I was invited to give this talk, I thought it will be a bit repetitive because most Swedes know what we're doing. And it will also be a bit boring because we are have been around for over 100 years. And 10 years ago when I started, we took a 10-year plan. We went from the Swedish average, 1.5 of the top one citations, to close to 7 last year. And we last year took a new 10-year strategy. So we're not going to change the strategy for our grants. Everyone knows where we are, and I think most people know about it, but I'm going to do it as a repetition. First of all, can you predict breakthrough science? I don't think so. But you can set the conditions for the scientists, for the creative scientists, to do the breakthrough. But it's always a risk. You can never know where it pops up. How can you foster breakthrough science? Select the best ones. Easier said than done, but I think everyone agrees on that. Give them long-term support. 5 years is, in my view, a minimum. 10 years is even more optimal. Otherwise, people don't dare to take a risk, especially not the young ones. The young ones will be stupid if they take too much risk early in the career because they will actually lose their jobs, which is not good for the family. And then give them freedom to do whatever science they want. My view is that scientists are so creative that they write the research plan according to how you announce the call. And then they reshape it when it's done so that it fits the purpose of the call, since it's creative people. So it's better to just to let them loose to do whatever they want immediately. Then they don't spend time to do the write-up. Don't chase them with too much detailed reports. And I think it's about 25 people in the audience that have money from us, and I hope you agree that we are not demanding too much detailed reports from you. And for young scientists, just hope for the best. It's very difficult to select young scientists, and I'm coming back to that, what the problem is, and but also what the upside is with young scientists. So are we. I mean, what we have said is easy. Go for the individuals, go for the best ones, and give them freedom. And I'm a great admirer in ERC. I think ERC has a fantastic thing that's set up, and most of what I said could be a copy of what the ERC is doing, but it actually isn't. Because this was that basic science, excellence, individuals, and freedom are key things. That was settled 102 years ago in the will of Knut and Alice Wallenberg. And I don't understand how they did it, because he was Minister of Foreign Affairs in Sweden. The First World War was still going on. And they said that it's science and education and it's basic science that is the key. They also brought in Landsganglit for the betterment of Sweden. And we are living every day with the word Landsganglit. Knut was the second generation. My former chairman was the fourth, and my current chairman is the fifth generation. Landsganglit for them means for the betterment of Sweden, not for the betterment of the Wallenberg companies. We are not allowed to talk about the companies in this sphere. Peter Jr. here is fostering the next generation of the Wallenbergs. And they are so fed up with the word Landsganglit that they said to me that maybe we should talk about something else for a while. But this is in the Wallenberg lifeline that they want to stay with this. So who are we? We finance about 1,000 scientists and 600 PhDs. A very remarkable figure is that over 60%, actually 64%, has a foreign PhD. The disadvantage is then you can wonder where the hell are all the Swedes, the people that took the basic training in Sweden. But in my view, I don't care. They can come from the moon if, as long as they do high-quality science in Sweden. We give out, as you see, substantial amount of money for Swedish standards, and we also can take money from for the strategic initiatives from our assets. It's 70% bottom-up and 30% strategic initiatives. But when we talk about strategy, it's a completely different thing to what others is doing. And I'm coming back to what we mean with strategics. Gunnar Ökvist will speak later. He was recruited by me because he was a professor in my department. And not really because he was the president of the department, but he was a permanent secretary of the Royal Academy. And you know, Gunnar had this. If you want to make friends, you should have Gunnar's job and Göran Hansson's job now. If you call the Nobel laureates in the morning, you get friends for life. So Gunnar helped us to invite a number of Nobel laureates. The current ones are the ones that you see up here, but it was others before that. And they helped us to set the strategy. And the strategy is excellence, individuals, and freedom. Actually, they want even more individuals and freedom than we have done, but yeah, they can't get everything they want. So personally, I think that you have to be on top of the review process. I know that it works very, very different in different funding agencies, but my view, in my work, I spend almost 0.5% of my time sitting into the review panels. I think it's about 10, 15 academy fellows in the audience. I'm listening to over 400 academy fellows interviews. I think I have a fairly good view on where young people are, what the problems they have, and how they try to sell the sciences. I think the review process, you have to be on top of it because it changes with time, and it changes with the political pressure. In Sweden, we have a very odd situation where Swedish Research Council is, of course, the main thing, which has a definition of scientific quality. But we have all our other granting agencies with strategic purposes, they have their own definition of what scientific quality is, which disturbs me a lot. And that can also be the difference between different evaluation groups. So I'm a great believer in peer review. It goes wrong. It's a very conservative thing. Some really brilliant things that is completely new will be crashed in the review process because the people that is reviewing don't understand how good it is. But it goes more often right than wrong. And then the question is there this genius scientist that can do the breakthrough without having a previous track record? It is possible, especially for young people. But I think that you have to learn the trade. You have to learn how to do science. I mean, science is not that you have just an idea. You have to have the system, you have to have the structure, and you have to have endurance. And that you have to learn in a research environment. And of course, the peer review system is ruling out the ones, the really unique ones, that think in a different way to most of us that come up with a brilliant idea, because they will not survive in the normal academic system. They used to, when the universities were more open. Not so much metrics. You could have people at the universities that could have their free thought as a driving force, but not today, because today we measure everything that people is doing. Is it more likely that seniors that have learned the trade can do the breakthrough than juniors? I don't think so. I think it's a matter of time, security, and resources. Where security is a key thing. You have to feel secure in the environment you have. You have to have the resources. And again, how can you demand from young people to take the risks? Well, if they take the risk and don't publish in 5 years' time, then they are lost. I have 3 kids in science, and I tell them, take risk, but play safe. You have to do both. And I think that there are many, many of the young scientists in the room that can comment on this. And then people ask us, how can you give them money to do whatever they want? I think you have especially some innovation agents in Sweden that has a completely different view on how to do this, where you want to have control of every single thing that the scientist is doing. Well, we believe that this is a key thing to get the breakthrough science. Give them freedom. And then, of course, we will discuss past performance versus the excellent ideas. You have to have both. For a senior scientist, you actually have to prove that you have done something, and then you have to have some excellent ideas. It's more difficult with young people, because a young person is often a result of the supervisor, the postdoc supervisor, and it's very hard to know if that person will be able to do it themselves. So productivity, relative creativity, of course creativity, but you have to produce. And it's not how long your publication list is the key publication that is the issue. So I'm going to talk about 2 programs, senior scientists, Wallenberg scholars, young scientists, Wallenberg fellows. So as you see, we have internal panels, but we also work very closely with the Royal Academy of Sciences. that runs several of our big programs. So for senior scientists, we have 5 to 8 international reviewers for every person that is tested. For young scientists, we have an academy panel and 3 international reviewers, where the interview is absolutely essential. You find young people that have 5 papers in science. They're absolutely excellent. And then you ask them, what is your research interest? What is your research idea? And then they say, no, I got this piece from my postdoc supervisor. No. What is your case? What do you want to develop? These are people that will not be funded. So interviews is absolutely essential. And then give out money without control. Yes, that's what we are doing. And actually, that's what the Swedish law says for foundations. When you take the donation, the money is gone. You can't retract the donation if you're going to look at it from a legal perspective. But there is another thing. In Sweden, it's the university that has the audit responsibility that is not that people is not fooling with the money. It's not the foundation agencies, at least not the private ones. Of course, I mean, we give people money without control, and we give them freedom. But if you have money from us for 5 years, you should have something produced if you're going to reapply, to put it that way. So our version of ERC, advanced grants, and the VR professorships is Wallenberg Scholars, Clinical Scholars. We have appointed 82, and we're going to appoint another 18 in the autumn. And when this is completely built up, they get 400,000 euros per year to do this. Some of these people have had these grants for 15 years now, and will probably have it until they retire, as long as they perform. With this, we stands for over 60% of this type of funding in Sweden, including VR and ERC. And we shouldn't be bigger than that. 100 is more than enough. But our proud and glory are the Wallenberg Academy Fellows, which is a combination of ERC starting grant and consolidator grants. They can get up to 10 years from us. We have allocated a lot of money to this. And as I said, I will be sitting in on the majority of the interviews. And many people have heard me say this before, but I want to repeat it. These people are extremely competent. They are verbal, they are mature. And every time I've been to one of these interviews, my take home for myself is that I'm extremely glad I'm not doing my career now. I wouldn't have had a chance against them. So this talk about that we don't foster excellent young scientists is not on. So we have financing of around 200, 36 years when they start, 40% females increasing, 60% foreigners, and they get a substantial amount of money and they can get up to 10 years. It's the best program we have. We also have projects, and we have allocated quite a lot of money to that. And of course, it should be competitive in the field. And one thing is it should be a coherent research question. People have a tendency to do work packages that is not linked together, and then when they get the grant, they go home and do whatever they always used to do. So we spend a lot of time with the international reviews to really try to see if it's groundbreaking research and if they are doing that together. It's easier said than done, but 5 to 8 reviewers gives at least some security in our process. I'm going to finish off with the strategic initiatives. There is, as we heard also in Europe, a lot of strategic initiatives where we hope that basic science and innovation will create good for the society. I think one thing one has to remember in the discussion is that Swedish research is financed by public money, and we have a democracy. So when the politicians take a decision, that's the way it's going to work. We can have different opinions of what you're doing, and I have a lot of opinions, but in a democracy, you have to really accept that's a process. My view is that the main job of a university is to educate people. Educate competent, mature people, and they will create great things in academia and in the public sector and in industry. The Wallenberg Foundation controls the majority of the big technology companies in Sweden. If you ask the CEOs what is most important, is it the research at the KTH Chalmers? And they say, no. It's the competence of the engineers, mathematicians, and this and that is important for us to stay in Sweden. And I think we have to keep this in mind when we discuss about scientific quality, that the universities also have a really important mission in educating good people. So what is strategic networking? I mean, we are not giving, we used to, 10 years ago, give money. We gave 1 billion crowns to a guy to do a protein atlas that has been extremely successful, but not on my watch. We are building critical mass, we're recruiting young people, grad schools. One example is molecular medicine. Sweden was in a bit of a crisis 6-7 years ago when AstraZeneca closed the main site, and people in life science knows about the problem here. So we said that we will create a network. Sci-Life Lab in Stockholm and Uppsala is to a certain extent funded by us. We started 4 centers in medicine in Gothenburg, Lund, Linköping, and Umeå. We provided recruitment packages for 40 scientists, international recruitments in molecular medicine, that was matched by 40 recruitments of clinicians by the local healthcare providers. And at Sci-Life Lab, there is about 25-30 Sci-Life fellows. So in total, you have a community of 120 people. And this is a result. They met 3 weeks ago. This is about 70 of the 110 new group leaders. They didn't exist 3.5 years ago. Most of them has come to Sweden after that. And then if you think that everyone has a starting package to recruit 4 to 5 people, in an average, there will be groups over 10 people. So you multiply that picture with another 10. That's a new community that we are built. And of course, we hope that they meet. This time we got Edward Moser, Nobel laureate, to explain how he did this research. And a part of that is, of course, to get the young group leaders to forget what university they belong to. Sorry for that, there is 2 rectors in the audience. But they should find people to work with at other places. Because I don't think that you can force people to work together. They have to work together because they want to work together. And this is one of the ways to do it. Another thing, and now we're not talking about breakthrough science. The Wallenbergs, who is in the leading position in the company, said, we had the Industry 4.0 in Germany, and everyone is investing in software, autonomous systems, and AI. And the Swedish companies will not survive if you're not doing anything. So we allocated 300 million euros that was co-financed mainly by the industry with 200 million. We have 80 recruitment packages for tenure positions, and we have filled about close to 40 of them with international recruitments. We are recruiting 10 top chairs in AI, which I thought was impossible, but it isn't. 80 has already accepted. 3 of them have CRC advanced grant. And the beauty with our system here is that the Wallenbergs can call the CEOs and the companies. So when these Wallenberg chairs came to Sweden to look for a position, they met the CTOs at all the major companies, which is not to happen in all countries. But the important thing is the 400 PhD students in the grad school. I'm going back to that. And we just took a decision that will be announced in 2 weeks that we started a program in WASP, Humanities and Society, to look at the consequences of a new technology shift. And Kerstin Salin, who is somewhere in the audience, there is Kerstin, she is chairman of the board, so if you want to know more about that, talk to Kerstin. If you get 400 good PhD students, 1/3 of them is industrial PhDs, and they have courses, they have social activities, they create a network for their life. The problem with these people is that they are so attractive on the job market that we have to find ways to keep them in Sweden. 40% of them has got job offers, international job offers, 1 year after they started the PhD training. And probably they get 10 times higher salary somewhere else than they get here. So far, very few of them has left, but that's the thing that we is looking for. Finally, we have the Wallenberg Academy Fellows here, where the Academy has organized them in mentor groups, and they have individual mentors, they are doing things together, and of course they create a network for the rest of their life. And this is of course at least a part of the future for Swedish science. We are sometimes criticized that we put so much effort on young people, and yes we do, but on the other hand we stand for 6% of the research funding in Sweden. And there is an ecosystem of funding, so I think our niche is to do that, and others can do other parts of the funding. I would like to finish off with two things. I think in an ecosystem where you are financiers, it is extremely important that you have diversity. It should be up to the scientists to divide if they want to go to VR, to us, to the strategic foundation, or the others. It shouldn't be the foundations that force them into a certain position. Secondly, I think we discuss too much the super scientists that will do the breakthrough. We are not discussing the scientific climate that we are losing in some departments. I see myself that PhD students are so occupied that they don't go to seminars anymore. I mean, if you're going to maintain a healthy academic environment in the best research fields, we have to have a seminar culture, we have to have a way for colleagues to criticize each other, to have an open debate about science. And I think that is as important as to identify the superstars. A superstar has a tendency to 5 years later not be a superstar. And to our surprise, a very junior scientist that has not proven themselves have a tendency to be a superstar 5 years later. I know from my own experience, maybe I know that others have been able to predict from day one which of the PhD students that will be a superstar. I've never been able to do that. And that's why I'm so happy that I'm trusting our review process. Because if me as director of the Wallenberg Foundation should go out and pick individual scientists, it would be a disaster with too many mistakes. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Göran. You will come back later today in a session where we can discuss more. So I think we actually thank you for now. And I have noted both the ecosystem importance with the diversity of funders and, of course, that we have to discuss the culture at the universities. Do you want to add something more to the list of good questions for the panel?
Yeah, I mean, we have a problem with the gender balance.
Yeah.
We don't have it with the fellows because the young females are so good. We really don't have it with the scholars, but with our projects, we have a terrible gender balance.
And this can be even worse when we see the problems with young boys in school today? Or?
Well, it will be a reverted gender balance. I don't know, 65% of the students...
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah. I'm not so worried about that. Just now I'm worried about that most of our projects are lacking female project leaders. But we are forcing the universities now. They don't know about that. But next year, 30% of our projects will be led by a woman. We give out 20 super big projects every year, which means that 6 should be run by a woman. And if only 4 passes international review, it will still be 30%, because next year we will only give out 12.
That's wonderful, Göran. And let's make this let's make place for a woman on stage. So, and you will come back. So please give a warm hand to Göran Sandberg.